We've been drawn together for this last, by the death of a great friend, a mother, a granny, a sister, and above all, a loving wife. Alan would, I'm sure, like me to start by welcoming all of you here and to thank you for being here. My name is William Fennelly, and I'm a friend of Maeve's for more years than does either of us credit. And we worked together in Deadstall. I was one of her. She really was an exceptional teacher, kind and always deeply present to the boys that she taught. And all too often, she managed to be the guardian of their better selves when they lost sight of that person through the hormonal mists of adolescence. I wasn't including myself in that. I'm really, really grateful that I've been invited to pray with you today. And I'm grateful to Father Ryan Carroll, the parish priest, for his very gracious and warm hospitality to me and to Alan and to many of today. It's appropriate that we're here in this very pretty little church, as Maeve and Alan lived so much of their married life just down the road, in between bouts of travel to more glamorous climes elsewhere. Maeve, though originally a Doug, never fully settled in Clare. I think it's fair to say that she was always a citizen of the wider world, rather than being someone tied to one place. She was a woman possessed of a very personal and a very strong faith, whose contours she wasn't going to let any mere priest define or constrain, but was really strong. It ran really deep in her. And as we prepare to give thanks for the gift of Maeve's life and her many accomplishments, and they are indeed too numerous to mention, I just want to first extend my deepest sympathies to you, Alan, Enda, Oisin, and Fionnuala, and of course those beloved grandchildren whom she loved with an unholy but very generous love. I'd also like to pray especially for her sisters, Aine, Fidel, Siobhan, Aine, Mairead, and Roisin, for her brothers, Kieran, Dermot, James, and Brian. It's a terribly sad day that not one of us ever wanted to come. But it's also a very powerful day where we're drawn together to give thanks for the huge blessing that this deeply loving, feisty, warm, and original woman was in our lives. There was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel." And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. The Gospel of the Lord. That gospel that we just heard is taken from a key moment in the nativity story of Jesus in Luke's gospel. And it tells the part of the story of how the elderly Simeon beholds salvation and calmly leaves the world. I don't think it's too fanciful to say that Maeve had such a very special Christmas with the most important person in her life, and she beheld salvation. She beheld salvation at Christmas, and she calmly left this life. It seems easy and consoling to imagine her saying, "Don't panic, don't panic, it's okay, I've got it, don't panic. Above all else, don't panic. I know exactly what I'm doing. I know where I'm going." But the notion that hers was a timely death is sadly misplaced, as she certainly felt that she had plenty more parenting with those children of hers to do, as they were barely approaching maturity. St. Thomas's words, "Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way," are surely our words today. But the calm assurance of Simeon and of Jesus make clear that the journey that Maeve has undertaken is right as part of each of our journeys. "I am the way, the truth, and the life," says the Lord. And so to follow Christ, we have to walk the walk he walked. Jesus, with his own life and death, has shown us how to live, how to love, and how to die. One of Maeve's great skills was to employ her tremendous warmth and humor to make others comfortable in a manner that she managed to make it seem effortless, which of course totally belies the tremendous intuitive perceptivity that she applied to such gentle and genuine effect. Heaven is certainly going to look just that bit better for having her there. The decor will certainly have just that little bit more flair than might otherwise have been the case with all those bishops setting things up. Maeve has fought such an amazing fight for the last 3 years. It's an extraordinary testament to her tenacity, her vigorous hold on life. But even more so, it speaks of her courageous and loving generosity, whether it was dancing with nurses in James's or learning the clarinet. She just never stopped living. And her love grew ever more intense for being so refined in that furnace of her suffering, with that bloody cancer. And in all that time, the great constant at her side has been the love of the good and gentle man you are, Alan. Your love for each other was all very impressive to my eyes, savage agent that I am. Right back to that strawberry field in Wexford, you two have been drawing ever closer together. Your presence at her side over the last months, and indeed forever, has been an edifying inspiration for all with eyes to see. When health and strength seem to have left her too vulnerable, your care, Alan, your faithfulness and steadiness lovingly held her in being and enabled her to give yet more. Maeve had an extraordinary talent for friendship, and she effortlessly made a whole bevy of friends from a bewildering wide range of places and interests, and each of them thought that they were her best buddy forever. She loved each of you with a powerful and relentless love. And she loved her children above all. And you are her lasting monument. No structure could be more fitting than you, because you carry the best of her in you. You are her legacy. The great African-American poet, Maya Angelou, who had some lovely words in her poem, When Great Trees Fall. Maeve's very fond of Maya Angelou, so I just thought it was appropriate to include them here. When great souls die, the air around us becomes light, rare, sterile. We breathe briefly. Our eyes briefly see with a hurtful clarity. Our memory, suddenly sharpened, examines, gnaws on kind words unsaid, on promised walks never taken. And when great souls die, after a period of peace, blooms slowly and always irregularly. Spaces fill with a kind of soothing electric vibration. Our senses restored, never to be the same, whisper to us, they existed. They existed. And we can be and be better, for they existed. Maeve, we loved you, and we're so much better for having known you. And my God, did you exist with an enthusiasm for life that did us all good. Go forth from this world, Maeve, free of pain and bearing all our love. Amen.
For Maeve, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, may she now be admitted to the company of the saints. Lord, hear us. We pray for our deceased friends and relatives, especially for Maeve's dad, Ben Casey, her mum, Maeve, known also as Lala, and Ben's sister, Auntie Sally, Maeve's brother, Seamus, and Alan's brother, David Williamson. Lord, hear us. We pray for Alan, who was such a kind and loving husband to Maeve. We ask you, Lord, to care for him until you reunite them both in your heavenly kingdom. Lord, hear us. We pray for Enda, Fanula, and Ushi, of whom Maeve was so proud and whom she loved so much. We pray also for her grandchildren, who give her such joy. May the knowledge that she loved them be an abiding grace in their lives. Lord, hear us. We pray for all who looked after Maeve in recent months and for the many doctors and nurses who cared for her, as well as her brother Brian, who donated his stem cells to Maeve, and her sister Aine, who was a dependable caregiver over the final days of Maeve's life. We remember with gratitude all in the Birkett Ward of St. James's Hospital, similarly all those in the Cancer Day Ward of University Hospital Limerick and Milford Home Care Team. May the Lord reward them for all of their care and goodness to Maeve. Lord, hear us. We pray for all of us assembled here to worship and give thanks, that God may strengthen us in our faith, hope, and love, and that God's consolation may reach us through our love for each other. Lord, hear us.
Thank you. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen.
It's been great having Father William here, a dear friend of my mum who, as he said, from that time working together at Glenstall Abbey. He told me a great story about a time when my mother went back for a visit to the school for a coffee after she had retired. Apparently word spread around the students who were learning. She had quite a lasting impression on many of their lives. As word got around, they apparently began sprinting from various corners of the school. You tell it very humorously, but these big lads went from almost full sprint to a sort of awkward-like stance right in front of her with a will-having-ness. I don't recall doing that for any of my past teachers in secondary school, so that goes to say something. But it did. It made me think about how many people my mum had a positive effect on over the years. There was always an open door policy at our home, to the point where, just as he thought he might have a free house for the weekend, one of my lovely aunties might just stop by for a night or two. Not that I had any parties planned or anything. We always had passers-by popping in for a cup of tea and a chat. Rarely a dull moment, especially around Easter time when we had such big parties. The effort my parents made to keep in contact with people meant the phone was rarely available when you wanted to make calls of your own in the evenings. So, God bless the mobile phones anyway. I think it's fair to say Mom was a true force of nature. That force of nature had various ways of expressing itself at times. Her and I were no strangers to butting heads, which in a sense may have dizzied some of my own perspective on just how great of a person she was. She spoke her mind, whether you wanted to hear it or not. But that strength of character has largely shaped the man who I am today. The lessons she taught me about perseverance, persistence, and facing problems head on are qualities my family will know I have her to thank for better or for worse. These past 6 years have given us who relied on her, albeit sometimes unwanted counsel, but just about enough time to prepare for life without her. But needless to say, my mother has left a queen-sized hole in so many of our lives. Now, I believe it's each of our responsibilities to fill that hole with the various activities which make us happy, just like she did. Be it reading, cycling, walking, playing tennis, or whatever it is that brings you joy. Do it, and do it often. There's a wonderful tradition here in Agonalo where members of the community get together and dig the grave for those who pass. Myself and my brother did what my mom would have wanted and joined in. There was Joe Mooney, John Lynch, Eamon Nihil, Conan Tyke Farrell, Aine Coleman, Donna Malloy, Michael Mack, and Liam Gavin, all getting stuck in yesterday. We were met with some thick roots close to the surface, which needed an axe to cut through. We then took turns passing shovels and pickaxes for a couple of feet before the rocks and stones started to get the better of us. A local man from just up the road delivered a little digger, which took us down another couple of feet before we met solid rock, too much even for the digger. As we waited for a couple of the senior men to return with a jackhammer, a few hot whiskies were poured, and a little robin fluttered around and even went deep into the grave. There was a beautiful sense of poetry which about the whole thing, which I know my mum would have appreciated. The open interpretation, allowing your own imagination to conclude the story, or leave it vague, just as it were. I'm sure many of you have been told, and it's been told here already, that Mum's final days were very peaceful and filled with love. The care she received was absolutely second to none, and not only from the healthcare professionals, but from one of her dear sisters, Aine. There are no words I can say to do justice to the care you gave my mom. I certainly speak from all of our family when I say thank you so, so much, Aine. We all love you. But my brother and sister were also incredible during what was the most challenging period of our lives. Fionnuala, over the years you've made the biggest effort to keep the glue of our family unstuck and always carving out the positives for the rest of us to appreciate. And a true leader by example with your actions and your attitude. The daily chats you had with Mum in her final months were an inspiration to make sure I had no regrets of my own. Mum and Dad did an amazing job with 2 out of 3 of us. But finally, Dad, Mr. Alan Williamson, where do you begin with this man? I could write 10 pages on you alone, but your dedication to our mother was nothing short of phenomenal. It seemed to grow stronger and stronger with time, as William alluded to as well. For all the love and respect Mum is receiving, it's fair to say you were a perfect match. The countless lives you've both impacted positively is truly astounding. Whether it's both of your students, those at the tennis club, and members of the community from Killaloo to Mount Shannon and further afield. Your friends and family in the US to the UK and everyone who holds you so dearly across Ireland. We may have lost a great woman, but we certainly still have a great man. The only way I know how to express my gratitude for everything you've done for our mother, especially over the past 6 months, and more permanently the past 3 and these last couple of weeks, is to repeat a phrase you've heard many, many times, and will certainly hear many more. Thanks, Dad. Our mother Maeve was a loving mother, a caring sister, daughter, and wife. To talk about her and not mention the love she had for her grandkids would be unjust. Oisin and Kiva had 13 great years with Damien. My own daughter, even at 18 months old, had her own special connection with Mima as well. So, I'll end now with the same phrase I used at Alala's funeral, another great Maeve, my mum's mum. In our hearts and in our minds, she'll live on forevermore.
Our dearest Maeve, daughter of Ben and Maeve, loving sister to 6 women and 4 brothers, wife of Alan, mother, grandmother, niece, aunt. My darling Maeve, my Irish twin. We shared a bed, we made the beds. We played house together, walked to school together, went to the shops together. We bathed together, and we brushed each other's hair, our dearest Maeve. Steadfast colleague and friend, dedicated teacher, dedicated to live life to the full. Maeve had so many strings to her bow, that one would wonder how one person can be blessed with so much energy, enthusiasm, and lust for life. My husband Jerry and I have an ongoing gag about Maeve's enthusiasm, and it goes, anyone fancy climbing Mount Kilimanjaro before breakfast? She liked to pack things in, our dearest Maeve. Maeve loved gathering, the more the merrier. More meant better parties, more conversation, and more people to dance with. Whereas our mother had summer parties in the garden in Dale Drive, Maeve's were here in Ogonalo, where she and Anna would extend their generosity and hospitality at Easter time. The family traveled from Dublin, Kerry, Malmo, Copenhagen, the UK, the US. We would arrive weighed down with legs of lamb, Easter eggs, and wine, of course. The main event was the Easter egg hunt, which happened initially in Ryan Bruce Fort, but mostly in Ryan Wood. The children of the family, mostly adults now, had a magical time finding them. Legendary times, our darling Maeve. At a certain point, in Maeve's fight with her illness, she no longer wanted it to dominate her life. She was only interested in living. Books, film, and music, lake swims, sea swims, recipes, tennis, cycling, or her latest absolute best bargain that she found. Our dearest Maeve. A little over 2 weeks ago, Maeve and I were gallivanting around Limerick City on our annual Christmas jaunt. Trips back to the car had to be made with our successful buys. Also, the ripe cheese from the market had to be ditched before launching into Grand Thomas. A tincture of alcohol was had at lunch, which brings me neatly back to another of Maeve's interests. Why? Where it came from, what food it might go with, and more importantly, where did you get it? Our dearest Maeve. Anyone who's met Maeve knows that their lives have been enriched. Her smile, her warmth, her laughter, her gift for conversation was boundless, questioning, teasing, and exploring with you. She was my confidant, my sounding board, my dearest Maeve. I don't know what we'll do without you. Heaven, if there is one, and I hope there is, we'll be lucky to have our dearest Maeve.